Right, thanks, Scott. Hi, everybody. Thanks for the great introduction. Indeed, calling from lockdown Melbourne, so staying safe home. Today, I want to share an experience that started a few years ago in working Dynamics 365, Dynamics CRM, also the server edition on premises, and then adding capabilities of machine learning, artificial intelligence. To make it more powerful. So I want to start from that experience and going into the more modern side of it. The modern side of it is sales insights, is where the AI capability is really taking power and taking off to the next level. And we'll see why in a moment. But I want to share with you a couple of experiences. Stock optimization and lead ranking. Two experiences that I've done, I said a few years ago, where there was a Dynamics on one side and machine learning running in Azure on the other side. And we said, okay, can we look into historical data that my customer of that time was collecting and see if this can help to do a couple of things. So let's see which ones. The first one is stock optimization. What are we trying to optimize here, really? Well, the use case is for a company in the cosmetic industry. They obviously produce a lot of creams, not sort of things that allocate in stock in different retail stores. And they sell online, but the use case was specifically for stores that are in different geographies, and they want to make sure that they optimize the stock, the availability of product. So, because obviously, you appreciate that if you run under stock, you're not able to serve the demand of your customers. If you're overstock, you allocate too much space, which costs in retail stores. So what happened? What happened is that we started tracking usage patterns using a combination of devices, wearable devices, your mobile phone with an app. Not tracking people, but more tracking what they were doing, but profiling people into a CRM, obviously, into in a user profile that contains not just your first name and last name and address, but also some personal information like your age, your gender, your skin type. And with the help of Azure IoT, we were tracking the location and also weather, so season in general, but also the daily weather. And machine learning was really looking into all of these and extract or identify some usage patterns and answer some questions like, a woman, 40 years old, today is a sunny day, I'm commuting from home to the office, and the product recommendation will come up in the app. Don't forget to apply your sunscreen, for example. But then that same recommendation that was not necessarily there not to push selling the product was also used to track whether that person was using that cream. Now it was a tick box to say yes, I remember to apply it. And this, along with information around location of the person and the stores that are around the place where he/she lives, it would define a location of product in stock. So machine learning helping that. Not only it helped to predict the demand for a specific product given all the conditions, but we realized over time that it will help the machine learning, the sort of services that we built, which I will give you a glance in a moment, helped to improve a few other attributes like it helped with upselling. So not only I recommend you to apply this sunscreen, but because I identified some other patterns, some other usage that you do, I recommend also these other products, these other products. Don't, maybe you are interested also to these things, or people in your area are also buying this other product. So he helped doing a bit of upselling. It definitely improved the appetency for a product. Appetency is a word that comes from the same root as appetite, you know? So he creates an appetite for a specific product. And then he helped also to reduce the churn rate. The churn rate is a measure of customer attrition, it's technically called, you know, in marketing or in sales space. So it's defined as the number of customers who discontinue a product or a service in general in a specific time period. You know, so I start working from home, I don't commute any longer, so I don't use a sunscreen any longer. So that is a measure of a churn rate. So the intention is to mitigate, to reduce this as much as possible, because then obviously it means that customers are not buying the product any longer. So this is overall the use case. I have a few technical slides and things, and obviously a few that are more from a business, from a use case perspective. The audience, as usual, is a nice variety of people, so I want to try to have both elements into my presentation. And I forgot to mention at the beginning, any questions, feel free to write in the chat. I'll pause at the end of this use case and check for any questions. If you have the possibility to go to unmute yourself, go in voice and ask the questions, don't be shy, please do so. Otherwise, I'll pause it at the end of this initial presentation and then take some questions and we'll carry on. So I have three major moments during these 50 minutes that we have together today. So from an IoT perspective, don't be intimidated with this architecture diagram if you're not coming from a technical background. What I want to share with you here really is a message around how IoT, the Internet of Things devices, are utilize or configure in Azure. Azure make it extremely simple to do it, if you know what you're doing, obviously. Providing a gateway for ingesting data in the millions of transactions in a very, very fast period of time. So think about all these devices. It can be your Fitbit. It can be obviously your mobile app on your phone, sharing information all the time about your location, about the connection with an API for the weather, and your typical route from home to the office or from some other A to B point, whatever that is, and keeping track of all this information, ingesting into what is called an IoT hub. From there, all this information, this plethora of data that comes into the hub has to be sort of normalized, processed. This stream is really, really a stream of data, has to be stored somewhere. And on top of that, then you can build a report, the like of Power BI. You can integrate with Dynamics, so displaying some nice dashboard, or analyze for identifying any insight and provide some actions, which is what machine learning does. Machine learning in general, not necessarily in Azure, machine learning as a practice is all based on data. You have no data, you have no machine learning. Machine learning is a branch of artificial intelligence that identifies data, identifies patterns in historical data. The more data you have, the more accurate may be the prediction. Because what machine learning does basically is, hey, I noticed that in the last 6 months, in the last year, in the last 5 years, you've been doing this. Or not you as an individual, but a class of people with those attributes, the age, the skin type, the location, have been doing these sort of things. Maybe I can predict, I can foresee what you would do given the same conditions. So we start from data, files, storage in general, but also API. So you know you can connect to any third-party system. Then you build what is called an experiment, and this experiment define a model, or actually train a model. So a train model is an analysis of all the historical data, then represented and built in a way that you can do demand estimation, outcome prediction, recommendation, sentiment analysis. I'm sure you're familiar with all of this. Now, sentiment analysis obviously is understanding what people are talking about, your brand, your product, what is the sentiment they are expressing, typical in social medias. Recommendation, I know we are all familiar with the Amazon model. People that bought this and also bought this and that product. Outcome prediction is more on if I do this, there is a likelihood that I get this outcome. I don't know, for example, I go to a bank, apply for a loan, the bank does a sort of a risk assessment based on my profile, based on people that in the past are like me, no? Say age, say income, housing, renting or owning. And then they say you are likely to be a good or a bad repayer. So then they give you a score. This outcome prediction. But today we'll be focusing on demand estimation. So I want to estimate the demand for a specific product in terms of quantity, so not in terms of likelihood. And the nice things about doing this demand estimation experiment in machine learning in Azure is that the output is a web service, completely as a service, so managed in the cloud, in Azure itself, with zero coding. So even if you're not a data scientist, even if you are not a developer, a programmer, you can build your own machine learning and integrate with any business application, including Dynamics. So let's have a look. There are two experiences of Azure Machine Learning. Machine Learning Studio is a classic experience, which is in the browser, studio.azureml.net. There is a modern one, which has a full integration with Azure DevOps. They actually call it MLOps, Machine Learning Operations, but I will be focusing on the classic experience now. So let me switch and go in the browser. Let me see, I have so many browsers open. Must be this one. Here we go. So studio.azure.ml, azureml.net, sorry, that's the URL that you want to use it. I may zoom a bit here so you can capture one more time. And then you sign in. To sign in, you just need a Microsoft account. If you don't have, you can sign up for an 8-hour trial completely free of charge. You don't even need a Microsoft account, so just sign in with a trial. Obviously, at the end of the day, at the end of the 8-hour trial, you will lose all your data. Otherwise, if you want to work with a free workspace for the incredible price of $0 per month, you have access to up to 10 gigabytes of storage for enterprise level where you want to retain your storage and apply a lot of additional scalability and performance improvement. Then obviously there is a price for it. But I'm not here to selling Machine Learning Studio. I'm talking about the experience. So let's sign in. I will need to sign in with a password that I hopefully remember. So with my Microsoft account, I don't need to stay signed in. And here we are. So, look, I'm not gonna go into all the details of building the experiment because it will probably not eat most of my time. So I will work with some pre-existing experiment. But if you have questions around it, get in touch. I share social coordinates later. And all these experiments, this is a sort of community person. Let's put it this way. As Scott mentioned at the beginning, I'm a Microsoft Regional Director and MVP, so I do a lot of writing besides public speaking. So all these experiments are open source, happy to share with the community. Some are already on my GitHub repo, some are in some articles around the world. So if you want more insight into the experiment, let's get in touch, please, so I can share more details. So which one do you want to do today? Shall we do this wine sommelier one? No, let's focus and let's do product demand estimation, okay? So product demand estimation is the one that I want to share with you. It's a machine learning studio. What it does, basically, it allows to build a flow of different actions that start from the data set. So this is my product sales. Okay, so let me visualize my product. So you see there is age range, and I have some values here, 20 to 29, 30, 39, 40, 49. I have genders, obviously M&F, skin type. I have a couple of skin types here. There may be more, obviously, and this is an acronym to memorize or to identify the skin type. I guess EUW is European white. Then we have weather, sunny, cloudy, raining, different temperature. I have some different values here, different products, and so on. So from here, then I start the analysis itself, and I train the model. So you will see here that I'm training the model. I train in two ways, with a linear regression or with a boosted decision tree. Now, how do I know which one is good, which one is not, and above all, which one should I use? Because if you look into machine learning here, I will see that there are anomaly detection, classification, clustering, regression. This is a type of regression. And you see there is Bayesian linear regression, boosted decision tree, ordinal regression, Poisson regression. Which one should I use? Well, look, the short answer is, befriend a data scientist. And that's the best way, because they will help you. If you don't know, obviously there is a quick help that can help you understand which one to use. Or in the worst case, you just try. You just try the different features and see which one works better. So in, for example, linear regression is purely statistics. You analyze a linear correlation between one value and the other one. So people in that age typically apply this product. People in this other age typically apply that product. There is a linear correlation. But this one wasn't the case for our customer. There is not necessarily a linear correlation between product and the different attributes of a person. So we went for a boosted decision tree. What the boosted decision tree does, I can visualize this, so you can appreciate the way a decision tree works. I mean, are you familiar with decision trees? I'm sure you are, right? A decision tree is ask me the first question, and then is yes or no, or maybe 0 and 1, or maybe less than 50%, more than 50%, and then go into the next question, then into the next question. So this is an example of a decision tree. Start with a product, less than this percentage, ask question around the weather, or ask question around the skin type. Less than 0% of sunny, then this is the number of products bought in a period of time, and so on. You can start also from another condition. So rather than starting from a product, the decision tree will start from the weather condition, and then it goes into gender and so on. So this is what machine learning does automatically. So you don't have to build this if-then-else condition. Machine Learning Studio will build this for you, zero line of coding. I haven't written a single line of code. At the end, you score the model, which is the prediction side of it, and generate a web service, which is available in here. Product demand estimation. So the web service would basically provide an endpoint that you can integrate with Logic Apps, with Power Automate, with any integration service, and even download as in an Excel spreadsheet. So let me do that. You can download an Excel spreadsheet. Excel has a plugin for so enable editing as a plugin that will connect. So trust this add-in. You see here, this is an Office add-in for Azure Machine Learning. This add-in will connect automatically to the service that we have just deployed. And then, in a moment, there we go. All right. And then say, enter some data. So let me put some sample data in here. You see, automatically I put some sample data in there. So this is gender, skin type, weather, and product. And then in here, so in column E, so give me the output. So in column E1, do the prediction. Okay, so click on predict. Okay, click on predict. I think I clicked. Is it working? Got it. Should do some prediction. And eventually, I don't know why it's taking so long.
Is E2, maybe.
Yeah, it says include headers, but why not? Let's try E2. Ah, stupid me. I need to select the range of data. Huh. That's it. I forgot to select the range of data. Here we go. Now the machine learning stuff is doing its magic. Here we go. And we got the score, okay? So this is basically telling you how many products is likely to be bought, how many of these products, this Antelios something, UV-Lite, UV-30's name of the product, will be bought by men with this skin type, with this weather condition, and there are a few other parameters. So all these at the end, going back here, all this at the end basically will feed my product stock. So I start from the device. The device is registered into IoT Central. IoT Central is an Azure service that provides registration for all these devices so that no one accidentally can tamper with the data that is in my IoT hub. So only registered device can stream data, telemetry data to the IoT hub. It's a form of security. Then this data is analyzed. Stream analytics is another component in Azure that analyze all this stream of data stored. Machine learning will look into the Azure storage, do the experiment or the magic that we have seen before, and then provide integration as a web service with Dynamics. You can do any way you want. You can use Logic Apps, Power Automate, build a script. I will show you actually a script in the next demo that connect to the endpoint, is a REST API, get the value back as a JSON file format, and then update the Dynamics entity with product stock. Okay, so any questions on this before I move on into the next thing? So let me go and see the conversation in the chat. No question for now, which is great. So we'll have also a few minutes also at the end for additional questions. So moving along, the next one. The next one is lead ranking. Now, lead ranking has a flavor, and I will tell you which one. First of all, this experiment was done a few years ago. Okay, so before you jump on and say, hey, I have a question. Actually, Dynamics 365 can do lead ranking now. Hold on, I know that. I'm gonna tell you about it. But let's go in order. First one, this is a very specific one. We have a different way of collecting leads. This is an education company, has over 15,000 leads per day globally. They operate in over 150 countries, global operations, 40,000 employees, so massive organization. They receive 50,000 leads per day through different channels. The website, filling a form, social networks, phone calls, emails, whatever. All these leads are not collected into Dynamics. Dynamics will just crash. So there is somewhere a side where all these leads are collected. But what we do in Dynamics is we rank the leads, and only the one that are absolutely important will go into Dynamics itself. Important for what? Important by different criteria. And we look into location, history. If you have a history as a customer, destination, where are you traveling to? So this is an education company. They provide language courses, typically English, in different destinations. So as a student, any age, you buy a package which includes traveling, hospitality, and your classes at some destination. From which channel? Where, how long are you going to stay? You know, and you get the idea. Gender, interest, time spent on the website, your age. So all these different criteria have an importance. And the color coding here is not coincidental. Each color has a weight. So history, conversation, is or time spent is a higher importance than age or program or interest and so on. And there are a few other criteria I didn't put on screen because I ran out of space. So basically, we introduce a ranked lead entity, which has all the attributes that we need and rank at the end. Also, this lead is attached to, so in a relationship with programs, duration, destination, so all the lookup values, not that identify each criterion. Before machine learning, this private education company was looking into millions of records in a dataset, Power BI, you may recognize the style, and have a look and see, obviously with some charts you can visualize this nicely and say, hey, look, actually in France or in Italy, you know, you can apply some filters, so there is more people that do this and that, and then you can drill down and analyze better and better. But obviously it takes a lot of time and a lot of effort, and is error prone, it's not scalable. So we introduce a solution for doing the ranking in machine learning. Now I'm gonna show you that quickly, but without spending too much time on it. Again, for additional information around this, get in touch. I'm happy to show you that. So is this sales lead ranking. So we start from all the CRM leads, and I have a subset of the entire data set here. So which country? So I have a few countries in here, as you can see: Italy, France, Spain, Germany. Obviously, this is an English course, so we have destinations like Cambridge, Oxford, Malta, Sydney. We have gender, we have different programs, we have some district, we have data requests. So you can see these are back to 2017. I mentioned this was a few years ago. In a similar way as we have seen before, we have the training, we have the scoring, we have the evaluation, and then we have a web service. So the web service, the web service as an endpoint, which I didn't show you before, but I can show you now, as an endpoint, which is this one here. See this one here. This endpoint you can invoke with a script. I will show you an example in C#, but it can be in any programming language. This is a REST API using a POST method. It is only your service, so you need to authenticate, you need to pass the API key here, and then you build a request in JSON with the different columns, with the different values, and then you get an answer with the score probability. So the likelihood that a person with that attribute, the lead will turn into an actual sale. And this is based on historical data, obviously. So I can do a quick test here in line. So someone from Italy, age 18, gender female, wants to attend English level 1 and wants to go to Cambridge, okay, for example. Then And obviously, I can add as many attributes as I want here. So this is just a purely an example. Here we go. It's doing the things. And you can see down here, the test returned 0.69. So 69% likelihood that someone with these attributes in the past has turned into an actual sales, right? So is this good enough to be promoted as a ranked lead in Dynamics? This is completely up to you. You set the threshold. Under 70%, disregard. Over 70%, move to Dynamics. This is completely up to you. How much you want to risk and lose, okay? So then go back to, let me go into Visual Studio and show you the script. So the script basically create a connection passing all the different values. I have hard-coded some values in here for country, age, gender, program, destination, but obviously the real script will extract this information from the staging lead table, not hard-coded, and then invoke asynchronously. All these endpoints are asynchronous, a machine learning experiment, passing the endpoint that we have seen before and the API key that is unique. This will return a response. Now, in this case, I'm purely displaying the response on screen, but otherwise this script will update Dynamics, do whatever you want. The machine learning experiment client is purely simple. If you can follow me on this, you will appreciate what it does. Is an HTTP client connection with an authorization bearer, post the messages JSON asynchronously and get the response back asynchronously. Okay, so simple as that. And if I run this for these three individuals, one 16 years old from Russia, 18 years old from Japan, and 20 years old from Italy, that wants to go to Cambridge and Oxford, then we'll get the response in JSON format again. And then you see the first one, 56%, 90%, 88%. So you also appreciate the difference, you know, between the changes. The third line is still from Italy, is still 20 years old. I don't remember if it was 18 or 20 years old, still a female, but instead of attending English level 1 in my test before, this is English level 3, and instead of going to Cambridge, is now going to Oxford. So before we had a likelihood of 69%, now the likelihood is 88%. So just changing a few parameters. And again, this is based on historical data. Okay, now that's it. Yes, that's it. So before we move on with the next one, usual check on questions. How would you compare using Azure ML versus Databricks? Right, okay, so Azure ML is more on the prediction side of it. So it identifies patterns in historical data with no coding. I mean, you can do coding, you can write in Python or in R, which is the programming language of the data scientist. And but typically, I mean, 90% of the use cases, you can address it without coding. And it can do this prediction and expose as a web services. Databricks works on existing data and analyze the data. And you can do it for sort of a statistical analysis, but it's not machine learning. Machine learning is beyond statistics. Machine learning is really about making scoring, so predicting value, where even when the conditions are not known. The typical statistical science or mathematical statistics, it would apply on label information, so information that you know from the beginning, so you know the conditions. Machine learning can even identify patterns in data that you don't know you actually have. It's probably an opportunity for another great session around machine learning, but that's the typical differences between any data analysis tool that can do analysis on existing data. Yes, identify patterns, but only if you know what you're looking at. And machine learning that can identify these patterns for you without even you knowing if this is the case. So for example, in going back here a moment, I mentioned that we have identified these characteristics, but if I feed them into machine learning another criteria that I have no idea whether it's valuable or not, machine learning will identify a trend and say, hey, look, you actually notice that people that are calling from that channel, assuming that channel is not a criteria for analysis, are turning into a sales more than people from this other channel. Oh, I didn't think about it. Thank you, Machine Learning Studio. You helped me identify this additional criteria. All right, now, in the interest of time, I have a few other things to show you, and which basically is fast forward. That examples were a few years ago. Let's move and modernize now this in the context of Dynamics 365 sales with AI capabilities. Because some of the capabilities that I mentioned are already in the product itself. So I'm looking for something here. Here we go. Yes. So, and these capabilities are in Dynamics 365 Sales Insight. So Microsoft has made really artificial intelligence a key element of its strategy. You're probably hearing a lot of key personalities at Microsoft pushing on AI. You can see evidence of how deeply invested they are throughout Dynamics 365, the suite, sales, customer service, marketing. They all have some AI capability in it. So some of the most exciting capabilities have been added over time. So in 2017, when I started building these experiments, there were very little known AI at all. Now these capabilities are coming more and more into the product, specifically in Sales Insight, which is not a product per se, but is sort of addition to the sales capability, where you can analyze all the data that are coming into Dynamics 365 and try to make sense of all these. For example, Assistant. Assistant is a feature that constantly scans communication to create some sort of actions, action cards, actually. These are displayed on different dashboards, and they provide users with sort of reminders of upcoming activities. They even make recommendations when you want to reach out to a contact, identify emails that need a response, send some alert on key milestones. So it's really your assistant that is all driven by AI capability. Auto capture, I will show you in a moment in the product. Analyze the emails, find all the messages that might be relevant to sales reps, and then display is right there in Dynamics 365 Sales so that you can action on that as well. And email engagement actually goes even further. So it helps your sales reps to understand how their contact in general are interacting through different channels, specifically through emails in this case. So for example, it can help follow an email message. So you can see when a recipient opens that email, or if in the email there is a URL, it will track whether the person has selected the URL, has opened an attachment, has responded to the email. So it can really make advanced tracking of the engagement through emails in this case. Relationship analytics is mostly around gathering sort of KPIs around activities and display this in a graphical representation. Forecasting, premium forecasting can help you sales reps to focus on revenue generation by providing a forecast based on a sales pipeline and historical data. going a bit, I'm skimming around this because I don't really use them all the time. Notes analysis monitors notes that you enter, you know, in the different entities, especially regarding if you have a meeting or a discussion with a customer, and it provides some supposedly intelligent suggestion or next step to undertake. But the one that I want to focus a bit more is the predictive lead and opportunity scoring. And this is why I don't need to do that experiment as I was doing before for predictive lead, for ranking. This is now built in the product. So this is a built-in feature that help prioritize leads and opportunities using machine learning. So there is a machine learning scoring model on the back end. We just don't see it, it's just happening. The predictive scoring helps identify the likelihood that a lead transition into an opportunity or an opportunity into an actual order, an actual sales. So then, you know, you can obviously focus on the one that are more important or more likely to win. So the way this works basically, that in your views for the open, there are a couple of views that come out with when you enable predictive lead and opportunity scoring. The my open leads scored, you get three columns. The lead score with a percentage as a likelihood. So this is exactly the same that we have seen before. That boy, male, that wants to go to Oxford to learn English level 3 from Italy, add 80%, 88%. Then you get the lead in here. Then you get a trend, which is also a very, very nice thing to do. A trend is identifies how the lead is trending, whether it's sort of improving or is steady or is declining compared to the past. So you show you also, you know, if there is an improvement, because I forgot to mention, but one great characteristic of machine learning is that it improves over time. It is machine learning, so it keeps on learning. So that means that every time you feed the more data, then this data is used to retrain the model. So you're not only looking to historical data, but every new lead, in this case, that comes into the system, is used to perfection the prediction model. So the accuracy improves over time. So if I disregard one's lead because I consider it not as high in rank, but then that lead turns into an actual sale and consistently that happens, so it creates now a new value, a new rank, a new importance for those conditions. So over time, that rank goes up, up, up again. So then the trend is improving. And a grade is just a label to, instead of showing this as a score, as a percentage, 0 to 100%, you can grade and you configure this on the back end. So you go into the AI setup, predictive lead scoring, and then you can say A is 100 to 64. You can change that. B, 63 to 43, down to D until you get to zero. So you can configure the scale just to have a grade A, B, C, D, rather than just a number. But it's purely for, say, reporting or visualization perspective, okay? So in summary, recap, you get these three fields. Lead score from zero to 100. A trend which identifies if the lead is going up or down historically or steady, and the grade, as I mentioned, just a representation through a letter. Okay, so now, if you were to enable Sales Insight, as I said, this is a sort of an add-on. You can do it through the configuration area. It is available in the current region, so not everywhere at the moment, because it does require some services like machine learning on Azure to run. So it has some regional limitation. In Europe and in the UK, it's all good. good for me as well in Australia. The latest version is 2020 release Wave 1, which has been released last March, I believe. And a few other notes, not available for governments anywhere, US, Singapore, Australia. I'm not sure if there is a government cloud in the UK, but if there isn't, the Sales Insight is not available in there. Some features are actually free, so you can just get the AI capability completely for free, nothing more to pay. I don't remember off the top of my head all of them. The URL you see on screen will tell you which one is free, which one you have to pay. Not all the features, actually, each feature you can enable or disable individually. So if you don't want, go back 1 second. If you don't want a premium forecasting, if you don't want a note analysis, you don't have to get all of them. So you enable auto capture, you enable email engagement, you enable relationship analytics, and so on. Okay. And big recommendation is use the out of the box entity, account, contact, lead, opportunity, not the custom one, because all this analysis that machine learning does is based on the custom out of the box entity. It doesn't work if you have another entity where you stole all your leads, for example, as I did by introducing a ranked lead some time ago. So that's all I wanted to say. Conscious of time, I want to give a few minutes for a few questions. Social coordinates on screen here. So if you want to get in touch, Twitter, LinkedIn, you'll find me. Happy to share also the code for the experiment that we have seen in machine learning. Any questions? Any doubts, any fears? All right, seems quite nice and peaceful. All right, so, okay, one more question. Are there any good data set available for lead scoring? There is a website, don't remember top of my head, but I can follow up and share this later, where there are some open source data set that contains years of data that you can use for your machine learning. Now, I don't remember exactly if there is anything for leads, because anything that I have done in the past was based on actual leads that the company was collecting. And what Sales Insight does now, it is all based on data that is inside CRM. So if you remember, I mentioned that the collection of all the leads for the education company was done externally to Dynamics, because 15,000 leads per day would probably not be manageable amount of leads in Dynamics. So we were collecting outside of it and then publish only the ranked one above 70% or 65%, I believe was the threshold. And the scoring on the leads depend a lot on the business model, so you want to rely on real data from your customer or from your company. All right then, Scott, back to you.